That's the one no money hope house.
Gracious God, be with us now as in the power of the Holy Spirit. We come to worship you, who through Jesus Christ saved us. And now Vivian's going to read our call to worship for us.
Psalm 100, a hymn of praise. Sing to the Lord, all the world. Worship the Lord with joy. Come before him with happy songs. Acknowledge that the Lord is good. He made us and we belong to him. We are his people. We are his flock. Into the temple gates with thanksgiving. Go into its courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise him. The Lord is good. His love is eternal, and his faithfulness lasts forever.
And so we're going to sing our call to worship now as we sing the hymn, Jubilate, Everybody.
Sorry, I'm at the wrong place.
Jubilate, everybody, serve the Lord in all your ways and come before his presence singing, enter now his courts with praise. For the Lord our God is gracious and his mercy everlasting. Jubilate, jubilate, jubilate.
Well, there we are. If ever there was a cucumber chorus, repeat plenty of times. There we go. Let's pray. Glorious God, we praise you, for you created the universe, its vastness, its intricacies, all echoes with your love and care. Saving Son, we praise you, for you came to die for us, to set us free from our sins, to enable us to live abundant lives, all echoes with your love and care. Sensitive Spirit, we praise you, for you came to draw us together in fellowship, to empower us to be busy with the work of the kingdom, all echoes with your love and care. Yet we know how often our lives are hollow echoes. We forget the wonders of our world and exploit them for ourselves. We forget the cost of our salvation and pursue only our selfish wants. We forget the joy which comes from loving and serving others and do only what pleases us. Forgive us, Lord, come cleanse and renew us. As we thank you for all we receive by your grace, we ask you to bless all we bring as our thanksgiving, our time, our skills, our money. We know they all come from you, but as we offer them, bless them and us in your service. As we, your people, now say together, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. This, believe it or not, is the last Sunday of the Christian year. Next Sunday is the first Sunday in Advent, and it will be the start of a new year in the Christian calendar. So today, as we reflect upon the end of the old and the beginning of the new in Jesus Christ, we see all is made complete. Christ is the King. It has been for us all an amazing year. So let's use the time as we sing the next hymn to reflect, to pray and to praise, and perhaps to rededicate ourselves. Lord, for the years. Now, this is where we enter the realm of technology beyond my ken. We're going to listen to a piece of music. And if you've got a drink in your hand, I would advise you to put it down. Zadok the Priest was written for the coronation of King George II by George Frederick Handel. And we have that sense of the procession of all the people slowly, slowly trekking along, and then bang, the words hit us. Zadok the Priest and Nathan the Prophet anointed Solomon King. It has been the practice at all coronations from at least 973, when St. Dunstan at that ceremony for King Edward established the fact that monarchs had to be anointed with holy oil and then crowned. Here we can see in this picture an event that happened on the 12th of May 1937. George VI has been anointed and crowned, and here are members of the nobility coming to offer their allegiance to the king. George VI was absolutely terrified at his coronation. He never expected to be king. Actually, he saw it as his duty to do so following the abdication of his older brother, David, known to us all as Edward VIII. Edward VIII never got anointed or crowned. Indeed, what happened was the authorities simply adapted the arrangements and made them for George and not Edward. Afterwards, George VI wrote this to the Archbishop of Canterbury. I felt I was being helped all the time by someone else, as you said I would. And he wrote someone else in capital letters. So where do you think King Jesus is anointed and crowned? Does he have a great bang moment, a Zadok the Priest moment? And is that at creation? Is he anointed and crowned as an infant in the manger or at the dedication in the temple? Is it when that woman comes and pours perfume over his head? Is it on the cross, at the resurrection, or at the ascension? Or will it be when Jesus returns in the age to come? I wonder if this hymn helps us answer that question. Jesus is Lord, creation's voice proclaims it.
Jesus,
And we're going to listen to our first reading now, which is taken from the Gospel of St. Matthew.
The Gospel of St. Matthew, chapter 25, verses 31 to 46. The sheep and the goats. When he finally arrives, blazing in beauty, and all his angels with him, the Son of Man will take his place on his glorious throne. Then all the nations will be arranged before him, and he will sort the people out, much as a shepherd sorts out sheep and goats, putting sheep to his right and goats to his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, "Enter, you are blessed by my Father. Take what's coming to you in this kingdom. It's been ready for you since the world's foundation, and here's why. I was hungry, and you fed me. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was homeless, and you gave me a room. I was shivering, and you gave me clothes. I was sick, and you stopped to visit. I was in prison, and you came to me." Then those sheep are going to say, "Master, what are you talking about? When did we ever see you hungry and feed you, thirsty and give you drink? And when did we ever see you sick or in prison or come to you?" Then the king will say, "I'm telling the solemn truth. Whenever you did one of these things to someone overlooked or ignored, that was me. You did it to me." Then he will turn to the goats, the ones on the left, and say, "Get out, worthless goats. You're good for nothing but the fires of hell." And why? "Because I was hungry and you gave me no meal. I was thirsty and you gave me no drink. I was homeless and you gave me no bed. I was shivering and you gave me no clothes. Sick and in prison and you've never visited." Then those goats are going to say, "Master, what are you talking about? When did we ever see you hungry or thirsty or homeless or shivering or sick or in prison and didn't help?" He will answer them, "I'm telling the solemn truth. Whenever you failed to do one of these things to someone who was being overlooked or ignored, that was me. You failed to do it for me." Then those goats will be herded to their eternal doom, but the sheep to their eternal reward.
Margaret and I were on holiday in Scotland a few years ago. We found ourselves on the South Deeside Road. It's the back road between Balmoral and Ballater. We were being followed by the school minibus, taking the school children home from Braemar. Approaching us were three Range Rovers, all driving down the middle of the road, and it was a narrow road. The minibus pulled over. It had a child to drop off, and wisely Margaret pulled over too, for this convoy of Range Rovers heading towards us was not stopping. The first car was driven by Her Majesty the Queen, followed by a car full of people in tweed, and finally the police. I discovered later the Queen is instructed never to stop between destinations when driving. You see, monarchs are different. The same is true in our reading from Matthew about the end times. King Jesus returns and sits on his glorious throne. This is a scene of judgment and all will be accountable. It does not make me feel comfortable, but that's my problem. There is an inevitability about what I have done. So how should I respond to this story? It rather gives me an opportunity to reconsider what my life has been like so far. My first thought is that I do not think it will be helpful if I get up and say I'm going to try and be more sheepy today and less goaty. If I decide on that route, I think I'm missing the key point in the story. The sheep did not set out to do good. They were not aware they were doing good. They were simply good. And perhaps I think it is because they know God's grace in their lives. They are filled with the Holy Spirit. They do not have to think about these things. They do them instinctively. It's all part of growing in the faith. As St. Paul puts it so well in 1 Corinthians 13, when I was an infant at my mother's breast, I gurgled and cooed like any infant. When I grew up, I left those infant ways for good. So how can I leave those infant ways? In my teenage years, I developed the habit of prefacing so many of my remarks with, "Oh my God." And I still remember my mum saying to me, "I do wish you wouldn't do that, love. It's not right, and it does upset me." And over time, I stopped saying it. I cut it out. Sometimes we have to stop doing things because health specialists tell us it's bad for us. And they can also tell us that things that will be good for us. It was in my 80s when my dad, following an overnight stay in hospital, stopped smoking. Something he had done at times to excess from his teenage years. And I was always in awe of his willpower to simply do that. Yet if we know something is wrong, why would we want to keep on doing it? It's as true of our spiritual as well as our physical lives. If we want to be more sheep than goat, we need to begin that process of doing things that please King Jesus. It could be bang, like the Zadok the priest moment, or it could be slowly removing what is wrong, but making sure we do it. Personally, there are things I have stopped doing recently. They are not good for me spiritually, and I'm feeling the better for that. I think we could be more sheep if we spend time in the company of other sheep. I'm very conscious this last year I've been using a phrase I heard over the years from a dear Christian friend of mine. They died last year. They always use this phrase as a way of expressing delight, thanks, and indeed excitement. And it could have been simply a view, a plate of food, or something they discovered from listening to a friend, or something they'd heard on the radio, or reading the Bible. Every time I hear myself using these words, I'm reminded of them, of their powerful witness for King Jesus, their devotion and faith, often in very challenging circumstances, that would surely have knocked me for six. And yes, it brings a sadness, but also great joy and thankfulness. I'm so grateful for knowing and being known by them. And I've been changed for the better through all of that. But I think the best way of becoming more sheep is to be in the company of the Good Shepherd, who leads me to green pastures, still waters. So as Val reminded us a few weeks ago, I have to ensure I have said yes to King Jesus, the Good Shepherd. Have I simply been tagging along for the ride? Or have I truly said yes to King Jesus? When I went to university, I was all alone. I knew nobody there. There were plenty of student societies who were happy to get you drunk and take your member subscription and then say goodbye. But one group stood out from them. They called themselves the Christian Union, and they were genuinely interested in me as a person. No getting drunk, then taking the money. The exact opposite, a real interest in me, Stephen Napton. I thought this was amazing. And so as not to hurt the feelings, I said I'd become a Christian in the summer. I hadn't a clue what I was talking about, and I can hear many of you saying, well, there's no change there then. However, one of the group, who surprisingly ended up becoming a URC minister as well, every morning when praying, kept getting a sense of, pray for Stephen Napton. It wouldn't go away. He was puzzled and spoke to somebody else who was older and more experienced in the Christian Union, who came to see me and asked if I knew King Jesus. I admitted I did not. And he told me what Jesus had done for me, how he had died for me to save me from all the wrong I had done, how I was forgiven because of all that and could be his friend forever. I remember now, after he left, I knelt by my bed and asked Jesus to be my saviour and friend. Now that was a bang, a Zadok the priest moment. And it continues to be, yes, King Jesus, every morning when I read the Bible and pray. Yes, King Jesus, every time I remember to be thankful for food and shelter and friends. Yes, King Jesus, every time I stop to think about how blessed I am. Yes, King Jesus, every time I am able to help others but don't realise it. Yes to King Jesus. I know there are many times when I do not do any of that, but still I know Jesus loves me. Still, by keeping closer to Jesus over the days, enjoying the fellowship of his friends, trying to be more of what King Jesus wants and less of what I want, am I getting more like those sheep? That's for others to say. What I would say is, if you have never said yes to King Jesus, do not put it off. Do it now, as soon as you can. I would testify it is the best thing I've ever done in my life. And I know there are so many others who would say the same. All the stuff I thought I would miss, well, not a bit of it. I've been so blessed in so many ways, seeking to live as King Jesus would want. As one of our hymns puts it, Lord of our lives, in living power remake us, self on the cross and Christ upon the throne. Past put behind us, for the future take us, Lord of our lives, to live for Christ alone. Let's just listen to these words from the letter to the Ephesians.
That's why, when I heard of the solid trust you have in the Master Jesus and your outpouring of love to all the followers of Jesus, I couldn't stop thanking God for you. Every time I prayed, I'd think of you and give thanks. But I do more than thank, I ask. Ask the God of our Master, Jesus Christ, the God of glory, to make you intelligent and discerning in knowing him personally. Your eyes focused and clear, so that you can see exactly what it is he is calling you to do. Grasp the immensity of this glorious way of life he has for his followers. Oh, and the utter extravagance of his work in us who trust him, endless energy, boundless strength. All this energy issues from Christ. God raised him from death and set him on a throne in deep heaven, in charge of running the universe, everything from galaxies to governments, no name and no power exempt from his rule. And not just for the time being, but forever. He is in charge of it all, has the final word on everything. At the center of all this, Christ rules the church. The church, you see, is not peripheral to the world. The world is peripheral to the church. The church is Christ's body, in which he speaks and acts, by which he fills everything with his presence.
And so now our prayers of intercession.
Let us pray. We pray for those who lead and govern us in this pandemic, for scientific advisors, decision makers, church leaders. Give them wisdom, we pray. For those who look after the sick, doctors, medics, carers, especially we remember Debs and Julia. Give them rest, refreshment, and strength, we pray. We pray for those we know who are ill, especially Chris, Eileen, Simon, Kathy, Zara, Angela, Richard, Margaret's family. Surround them with love and bring healing, we pray. We pray for those who look after the hungry, running food banks, providing for others. Give them gentleness and compassion in their dealings with others, we pray. We pray for those worrying about paying bills and providing food for their family. May they find support, generosity, and love. We pray for those who look after children and young people, for teachers and support staff. Especially we pray for Lauren, Mark, Kate, Elena, and Matthew. Bless and strengthen them and keep them safe, we pray. We pray for our young people, for junior church and pilots who are not able to meet at the moment. May they know they are not forgotten by you or by us. A moment now for you to add any prayers of your own. Lord, we bring you these, our prayer requests, knowing that sometimes we are called to be the answer. So we pray, open our eyes to see you at work, our ears to hear the prompting of your spirit, and our hearts to show your love. When you call, Lord, let us hear an answer. When you come again, Lord, let us be ready. Amen.
We sing the hymn, I cannot tell why he who angels worship.
He whom angels worship. should see the wonder to bring them back. They know not how or when, but this I know.
Boy. Sorry, you speak.
Let's close some words of Richard Roll, who lived in the first part of the 14th century. Come to us, O Christ, as the wind that blows the autumn leaves, as the song that soothes the troubled child, as the melody that lifts the anxious spirit. Fill us with affection for you that is unbounded, desire for you that is unrestrained, and a yearning for you that throws caution to the winds, and this for your own love's sake. And so may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.
Amen.